You don't want to miss this episode of the AI Show where Tracy Chen talks about batch endpoints. Stay tuned. Hi, Tracy.
Hi, B.
Welcome. Welcome to the AI Show. I'm super excited to have you on the AI Show, as you know, because I love your features. So I'm really excited about what you have to tell us today.
Thank you. I'm so excited to be here, too.
Awesome. Well, just to begin, you know, obviously I know who you are and I know what you do, but a lot of people out there may not. So tell us who you are and what you do.
Sure. So my name is Tracy Chen. I'm the product manager for Azure Machine Learning Batch Inference.
All right. So what is batch inference?
So batch inference and the newest released feature called batch endpoint is a new experience we built for you to deploy a model in a turnkey manner to run batch inference. And basically, the batch endpoints manage the computer resources for you. When you invoke the batch endpoint, an offline job will be triggered. The service auto brings up a computer cluster to run batch inference workload for you. And after the job is completed, the computer cluster is automatically taken down and you can find the inferences stored in the cloud storage of your choice. And the best thing out of it is you only pay the computer resources you actually use.
All right, so you're talking about batch endpoints, but people here may have heard of online endpoints, and I'm just wondering how they compare.
Yeah, a great question. So these are actually two different type of endpoints targeting for slightly different use cases. Batch endpoint is for batch inference, where the latency to get the inference is not critical, usually in minutes, hours, or even days. While online endpoint is for real-time inference, where it's critical for you to get the inference right away, like in milliseconds or seconds. Both share the same concepts of endpoint and deployment, but due to the nature of the different latency expectations, the invocation behavior is totally different. When you invoke a batch endpoint, you pass in a data reference and it runs as a synchronous job to process the entire data at once. Compute is only provisioned when the job starts and the inferences are stored in cloud. While for online endpoint, you pass in the data through the HTTP request directly and the inference is sent back through the response immediately. Compute used by online endpoint is provisioned at the time of deployment and is always up and running to be ready anytime to receive a request. So another slight difference is batch endpoint only has one default deployment, while online endpoint can split traffic among several deployments.
Okay, so you're telling us that latency is really like the main difference. There's other differences, but latency, right, is really the key here, that with online endpoints, latency is much shorter and batch endpoints is much longer. So why would somebody choose an endpoint that has like a longer latency?
Great question. So there are actually several aspects you can check whether batch endpoint fit your use case. The first one is, like you mentioned, right, how soon you need the inference. If your latency requirement is relaxed, go with batch endpoints. And the second is how much computer power is actually needed and if cost is a big concern. You have the flexibility to use low-end compute and run a bit longer if using batch endpoints. And the third is how often do you need to inference? For example, you may only need to get inferences once every hour. Then you can accumulate the incoming new data to a certain amount and invoke the endpoint one time when the data is ready and on maybe sometimes on time schedule.
All right, so there could be significant cost savings and if people have the right scenario, if they use batch endpoints, right? Yeah, that's pretty amazing. Everybody likes to save money. I like to save money. So these are in preview and before, right? Okay, so and then before batch endpoints, we had parallel step. So some people watching this interview, they may be using parallel step today. Why should they switch to batch endpoints?
Yeah, we do have a lot of users currently using parallel run step to run batch inference. And it was released last year, primarily used through the Python SDK we're providing. While customers are really happy about the experience, the performance, and the scale parallel run step provides, we also receive feedback that there might be a steep learning curve to use it for the first time. So basically, you need to construct a pipeline at a parallel step, prepare the environment, write a SQL script, create a data set, publish a pipeline to get an endpoint. So it's a like quite a long journey. But comparing to parallel step, right? Batch endpoints provide a command line interface-based experience, which is more intuitive and easier to use. Also, there are fewer concepts you need to learn. And basically, you have your model ready, wrap it with computer resources and several configs in a YAML file, and run simple commands, and you are all set.
Nice. That does seem a lot easier. I mean, having used pipelines and batch endpoints, I do agree that it's better, quicker to just use batch endpoints. So you said that like people can use the V2 CLI with batch endpoints, right?
Yeah.
But they can't use the Python SDK. Is that correct?
Yeah, no. For now, no Python SDK, but you can use V2 CLI or REST or UI.
Okay, so they do have like three different options that they can use. Awesome. Yeah. All right, so can we see a demo?
Sure, happy to show. So I'm gonna show you how to use a V2 CLI to run batch inference using batch endpoints. So first step here is you need to create a batch endpoint. The most convenient way to do so is just to run this batch endpoint create command and provide a name of your endpoint. You can also provide a simple YAML like this one, and the key property here is the name of the endpoint. It is used to identify your endpoint, and also a requirement for this is it needs to be unique across the entire region. Because if you as I mentioned before, we can also use REST API to consume the endpoint. And this is actually the scoring URL, right? Which will be used to trigger through the REST API. And then here you can see it's identified by the endpoint name plus the region. So this endpoint name needs to be unique across the region. And now the next step is ready. Once you have the endpoint ready, the next step is create a batch deployment under the endpoint you just created by running this command, batch deployment create, giving the endpoint name, a YAML file defines the deployment, and then you can add this set default parameter to make this newly created deployment the default one under the endpoint. So
I want to add something here. So people who may have been using this feature longer than 2-3 weeks ago, they were probably used to doing these two steps in one, right? You could put the deployment and the endpoint in one step. So I just want to kind of make it clear. If you've used this before, forget what you've learned. Do this. Do what Tracy is showing you. Do it in two steps.
Yeah. Yes, thanks for brought that up. Okay. Yeah. Maybe let's quickly look at what will be the YAML definition looks like for the deployment. So this is a sample YAML I'm used to run this command. Basically, you wrap the model. It can be a local model or it can also be a register model. And then this is the scoring script. It tells us how you actually use this model through this script. And then this is the environment definition to host the model. And then here is the computer resources where you want to run the actual batch inference workload. And there are also a bunch of optional advanced settings you can tune to get the best performance out of it. So after you run this command, and add a set default, now you will have this deployment added to this endpoint you specified here.
Okay.
And then, it's basically till now with two command runs, it's all set, right? You can directly invoke the batch endpoint to trigger a job, which is actually doing the batch inference workload. So while you invoke the batch endpoint, you need to pass in a data reference pointing to the input data. For example, here I'm pointing to a folder containing MNIST data with thousands of images. And a good thing about this invocation is that you can also adjust some of the settings. For example, for this invocation, I'm using more instance counters, which is basically how many computer nodes for this specific job run. So I increase this number so that I can speed up the entire processing for this specific batch inference job.
Nice.
Now, after the invocation, right, you will get a job name with, from the response, which is usually a GUID. Then another very convenient command here is that you can just run azml job show, giving the name and plus this magic parameter dash dash web.
Okay.
And git click, it will magically open up the portal, the studio UI that you can use to monitor the job.
That's cool.
Yeah, like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the job may take some time to process. So I'm open up, already completed the job here. So if you see this box marked as completed, that means the batch inference job is completed, right? Then you can right click this box and navigate to access data. This is where the storage location where we store all the batch inference results. So I have pre-opened the results here. So basically you have this one file containing all your inference scores, and you will like to put an input identifier here, something like a file name to correlate with the score you get for that file. So this is a sample result you can see.
Nice. And that file name, you have to do it yourself, right? You have to write the code for that yourself in the score file,
exactly.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. This is awesome. I love it. You have another demo for us, right?
Yeah, exactly. So with this command line interface, it makes you very easy to set up a CI/CD pipeline. So my next demo is about how to set the CI/CD pipeline with those simple CLI commands. So what I have here is an end-to-end CI/CD pipeline, allows you to train a model first, and then after the train is completed, a new model is generated, it will auto kick off a new deployment under an existing batch endpoints. So you can add like different triggers here. For example, you can just run the workflow by simply triggers here, or maybe you can add other triggers like submit a new PR. So yeah, this workflow will take some time. So let me quickly open the previous side round workflow, now, especially for the auto deployment one. So here, right, yeah, after the training, there will be a new model produced. You can like register a model in your Azure Machine Learning workspace, or you can download it to your local file. And then what you would like to do here is you may want to create a new batch deployment, host the new created model, but without setting the default yet. Imagine you already have batch endpoints up and running in your production environments. Now you want to replace the existing model with a new version, right? You want to properly test it before switch it to the default one. So yeah, first step, right, create a new batch endpoint deployment under the same batch endpoint you have without setting as a default. Then verify the deployment and make sure everything works as you expected. So if everything goes well, then you can have the third step here, which is switch to the default deployment. So as I mentioned earlier, one batch endpoint can only have one default deployment, and that default deployment will be used when you invoke the batch endpoints. So after this step, this new new deployment, which hosting the new model, is replacing your old deployment. Now you can safely delete the old one. And after running these four steps, you will have the same batch endpoint with the same identifier, which is an endpoint name, but now running a brand new model.
Nice. I love it. I love it. I think people do too. So where can people go to find out more about this?
Oh, yeah, sure. So there are several useful links. The first one is this concept doc. It majorly talks about what is batch endpoint, what is deployment, what are the major features we build for you. And then the second one is the how-to document. It basically goes through the step-by-step guideline plus a working sample, as just showed in the first demo. And then the third is a sample CI/CD pipeline repo that I built, and this exactly is the second demo I showed.
Awesome. This is great. Thank you so much, Tracy. It was really great to have you on the show.
Thank you, Vee.
In this episode of the AI show, you saw how to create a deployment, how to create a batch endpoint, and how to invoke the batch endpoint. You also saw that you can use GitHub Actions to streamline your development process. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.